Welcome to the Relationship Recovery Podcast, hosted by Jessica Knight, a certified life coach who specializes in narcissistic and emotional abuse. This podcast is intended to help you identify manipulative and abusive behavior, set boundaries with yourself and others, and heal the relationship with yourself so you can learn to love in a healthy way.
On today's podcast, I have Manjit Ruprai. I initially found Manjit and her videos on TikTok when I was learning what a narcissist is and how the abuse shows up in our life. But she is a qualified and experienced EMDR therapist, counselor, and clinical hypnotherapist that specializes in narcissistic abuse and trauma. She works to support many people to figure out who they are dealing with and to move forward with their lives. She works globally via Zoom and is also the author of Survival Guide for Toxic Narcissistic Relationships, which is available on Amazon. Manjit's book, which we touch on towards the end of the podcast, is one of the first steps in healing from narcissistic abuse, as it is very simple. It is easy to understand, and it's not as complex as some of the other texts out there. This episode covers what a narcissist is, how narcissism shows up, how the narcissist was created, and what the abuse looks like. There are so many nuggets in this episode, and I feel like I could have talked to Manjit forever, but we are already working on her coming back. So I really hope that you enjoy this episode. If you have questions or if you want to find her, I will post all of her links in the show notes. I hope you enjoy this conversation. Thank you so much for joining me today. Do you mind introducing yourself and telling us who you are and how you got into this work?
So I'm Manjit Ruprai, and I'm a narcissistic abuse recovery therapist. And I got into this work after going through narcissistic abuse myself. So I realized around 7 years ago that I'd been a victim of abuse. And narcissism was very, very new to me. I had no idea what that was before that. I'd heard of the term before, but I didn't actually know, you know, the real depths of narcissism. So, you know, I realized I've never really had healthy relationships. But probably apart from one of them, all of my relationships have been very toxic and unhealthy. And I also realized I have a narcissistic mother as well. So after my own journey and working through my own trauma and realizing that I'm codependent, I started working with others. And, you know, I have a client base all over the world. You know, I find that a lot of victims are invalidated and made to look and feel very crazy. It's a huge thing that they go through, because that's how I felt. They do not know what they are dealing with and their own hidden trauma. So I love my work, and I'm so passionate about helping other people and spreading awareness about narcissism. You know, I wake up every morning and I have so much joy in my work and I'm ready for the day. I didn't actually know that my work would grow so much either. I'm so truly blessed and grateful that people find my information and work with me helpful.
Yeah. You know, I mentioned to you when we were chatting before that I found you when I was trying to educate myself and understand what was happening. Like, I was having a really hard time connecting the dots of seeing this behavioral pattern that was happening, but not really understanding even what a narcissist was. Do you feel like, for you in your story, do you think that educating yourself on what this actually is and what's going on was the first step to begin, I guess, like unpacking, I guess maybe the first step to healing? Do you think understanding what it was the first step in your healing?
I absolutely agree. I mean, I'm 44 years old, and I mean, I've had years and years of chaos. I think understanding, which can take a very, very long time, because it's such a complex disorder, and what you go through is very complicated as well. So, I mean, I think unpacking your own trauma is so vital for you to move on. And I always say that education on narcissism will actually help you to get your head around it and kickstart your healing journey.
Mm-hmm.
There's so much information out there as well. So grateful for that as well.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, with so much on social media, I often feel that things can get convoluted, you know, like when there's a post every 6 seconds about gaslighting. But at least when it comes to narcissism, I think that it's definitely a doorway into understanding what's going on because so many things repeat themselves. How do you define a narcissist?
So for me, narcissism is a mental disorder where an individual, they have an inflated sense of their own importance, need for excessive attention and admiration. They always form troubled relationships with everyone around them, and they have a severe lack of empathy in how their behavior and their actions affect others. So narcissists, they wear a mask of confidence in front of other people, but behind that confidence, there is someone with such low self-esteem, and they behave irrationally to any form of criticism. Really deep down, narcissists are so miserable, and they project this misery onto other people around them.
I've heard before that the narcissist's brain is actually wired differently. Do you believe that to be true?
Absolutely. So a narcissist's brain is definitely wired differently. But firstly, we have to look at what causes narcissistic personality disorder. So narcissism, it develops in childhood from trauma, a narcissistic parent, neglect, abandonment, parental illness, bullying, loss, or some kind of trauma or abuse that child has suffered. Also, the child could be a golden child or a scapegoat. It doesn't really matter because the role could switch depending on what the parent wants. But often the golden child may develop narcissism because they've learned to be manipulative, that parent has taught them that. But also the scapegoat may also develop narcissism as well, but the role could switch at any time. Either way, the child has to grow up in a very dysfunctional environment. As a result of this toxic environment, the brain does not develop empathy, and this leads to developing narcissism and a mentally disordered way of thinking. So this is why narcissists are described like children, because they've never developed. They have, can be a little bit toddler-like at times where they have tantrums. They've not matured or grown up in many ways. And really, our brain is developing until we are 25 years old. And the narcissists have been emotionally stunted as a child. But I wrote a book over a year ago. There's actually some research that I presented in the book, and this was carried out by a German psychiatrist, Dr. Stephen Ruprai. Mm-hmm. And he found in a group of people diagnosed with narcissism that they have gray matter in the cerebral cortex where we carry empathy. This is why narcissists cannot feel what they feel. They can't feel what we feel, and they struggle to see the world through other people's emotions. But the sad thing is there's no cure for NPD, narcissism either. The part of the brain is really cannot develop empathy later on in adulthood. So it's a very horrible mental disorder.
Yeah, yeah. And I think something I see often with my clients is that they'll be with a partner that didn't go through abuse the way that I think we typically think about it, of, you know, the child being neglected or hit, you know. And I actually come from a history of abuse, like of when I was an adolescent, and I definitely didn't turn out to be a narcissist.
Sure.
But I actually had a partner that he was the middle child, and his brother, older brother, was very successful and like very good looking, like one of those kids that does, he's good at everything he does, you know? And I explained this to some clients sometimes that, you know, sometimes it's not, they had a horrible past, but it's
They had a complicated upbringing that led them to have unhealthy coping mechanisms. And this, you know, this sort of snowballed. Yeah. And I just think it's interesting to think about. I love how you phrase it, that they can act like a toddler at times. And
absolutely.
Yeah. You know, and do you think that that's why there are so many undiagnosed narcissists, that they don't look inside, or they don't have the ability to look inside?
Yeah, I think narcissists, they do have trouble reflecting on themselves. So, you know, they're so miserable inside, but they do actually blame everybody else for that misery, but that self-reflection isn't there. But there was some really interesting research carried out on the back of what you said, that, you know, I have a narcissistic mother, but I'm definitely not a narcissist myself. But it is actually a chessboard family. That was some research carried out by Shannon, that's in my book as well. But it's a chessboard family, and that parent really kind of defines maybe what your role is in that family. And I've always been a scapegoat, maybe blamed for a lot of things in my family, but, you know, not everybody, you know, kind of will develop narcissism growing up in that household either.
Yeah. And so we know that a lot of people that get into a relationship with a narcissist have no idea 90% of the time, or if not more than that. What are some behavioral signs that somebody can look out for that would show them that they might be with a narcissist?
Okay. So early signs. So under kind of DSM-5, if the person you are with has five or more of the nine traits that I'm going to tell you about, you are likely dealing with a narcissist. So number one, an inflated sense of self-importance. Two, a lack of empathy. Three, jealousy or envious of others, or believe others are envious of them. Four, they mirror their victims. Five, they exploit their victims without any guilt or shame. Six, have a sense of entitlement. Seven, they crave constant admiration. Eight, they display arrogance. Nine, they have a preoccupation of fantasies. So I always say that, have we all got some of this? Possibly. Do we get envious of other people at times? Yes, but it really does depend on how far you're going to go with this and how much you're going to hurt another person. So, you know, sometimes we might, I don't know, we really may fantasize about certain things, but how far do you go in hurting other people? So we say to look out for a person's behavior and whether their words reflect what they are actually telling you.
That's a great one to name. Yeah. I'm so glad that you said that. And I didn't think about it until you said it, that the words and the actions actually start misaligning so early on.
Oh, of course. Absolutely. Absolutely. So I think they're vital things to look out for. You know, kind of often, you know, most will go through the love bombing process, but really their behavior does change much, much later on. So a lot of key signs to look out for in behavior change, actions, and words.
Yeah. What are some body language signs that you might notice a narcissist would do? And this doesn't necessarily have to be early on in the relationship, but just in general.
Okay, so I'm going to tell you about some body language signs, but that people do get confused that are these body language signs in other disorders or a learning difference, which is okay. But I am specifically going to link this with narcissism, but also their actions and behavior. So it's not just body language sign, it's everything as a whole. So these body language signs, which and with the traits of narcissists coupled together, will help to define the kind of person you could be dealing with. But you've got to also remember that abuse is abuse, but you do not have to look for a specific label, because we all know that narcissists rarely get diagnosed. So a narcissist might display the following body language, and I've done some videos on this as well. So probably have no eye contact with other people. Facial expression isn't warming or inviting, and this will change in certain situations, and their eyes may sometimes go dark. Might also see like a narcissistic smirk and, you know, kind of glint in their eyes, which, you know, if you've seen that, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. They do ignore new people, make you feel that you're not there. Not interested in people unless they bring something to them. They can boast about their own accomplishments or share things that they've done when nobody else has asked about it. They will bring the conversation back to them, mm-hmm. not interested in what someone else has to say. They will look over, you know, kind of the other person's shoulder, over their own, acting like so they're not interested in what you have to say. So this could link into other disorders, but I'm specifically referring this to narcissists.
Yeah. And so one of the things that I wanted to ask you was about covert narcissism, which we hear a lot about. And a lot of these signs I know come up, and that might be the first thing that you actually notice if you have a covert narcissist. It might be the way that they are interacting with you and showing up for you rather than some of the things that are said and how they behave and act and think. How do you define a covert narcissist?
Okay. So covert narcissists are the most manipulative, and really they can get away with it for years and decades. Mm-hmm. And without that person even knowing that they are actually a narcissist, they're not your typical narcissist where they have the grandiosity about them. They're more extrovert. And covert narcissists have fewer signs of the classic narcissistic personality disorder. And this includes shyness and being withdrawn, mm-hmm. self-consciousness, displaying a high level of insecurity and defensiveness, sensitivity to what others think about them. They play the victim very, very well. They could put themselves down and gain sympathy, and this acts as a source of supply for them. They are highly sensitive to criticism. They could be passive-aggressive. They do not like to be center of attention, but will gain supply by being withdrawn and shy. They can actually be very depressed and anxious, and this can get confused with depression. And really, some of them present as suicidal. They may have attempted it. This further may keep the victim trapped and feel guilty about leaving. And I have a few clients that have gone through that. So on the whole, a covert narcissist, they're very subtle in their abusive ways, and they can get away with it for mm-hmm. many, many years and decades.
Does it increase over time? Like, would that abuse increase? Like, would it become less covert and more overt? Or could it be happening in a covert way just for this prolonged period of time?
It can actually change. Some of them, you know, some of my clients, they're with a covert narcissist, but that can actually change to mm-hmm. something more overt.
Yeah.
Because I think really that the more boundaries, we know that the more boundaries you have with a narcissist, the worse the abuse gets. So that can actually change them to more overt.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but I think for the vast majority, the covert, they could get away. They might kind of dip in and out very briefly, but, you know, stay in that kind of covert role.
Yeah. Okay. That could be even more damaging over time because it would probably be harder to put together the pieces of what's going on.
Absolutely.
Yeah. What would you define as a narcissistic injury?
So a narcissistic injury occurs when a narcissist feels criticism or judged of a boundary placed on them. So a narcissistic injury is when you see the narcissist at its worst and full force of harm towards you. Mm. And really, the more boundaries you have, the more this hurts a narcissist's self-esteem, so the abuse gets worse. Mm. So I do say that a narcissistic injury, when you've criticized them, hurt their feelings, that can turn into a horrible narcissistic rage, putting you into, some people, quite danger. And you really see the worst of the narcissist, where they're yelling at you, screaming at you. The abuse has got much worse. Sometimes they may even harm you physically and cower over you, yelling and screaming. So really, the narcissistic injury is when you truly hurt the narcissist's feelings and you put a severe boundary on them, and this leads to a narcissistic rage where they're going to hurt you or carry out a vengeful act on you.
Okay. And so it seems, though, that almost anything can upset a narcissist, right? It's almost as if the rules of normal relationships or healthy relationships or non-narcissistic relationships just don't apply here. And so would you say that somebody's almost at risk of imposing a narcissistic injury at any time with almost anything if they're dealing with a narcissist?
Absolutely. This could happen at any time. And we know that narcissists, they get offended and criticized by any little thing. So you could be, you know, just kind of going about your business and they do not like something that you've done or said. It could even be just a reasonable question you've asked them. And this could set off a narcissistic rage anytime. Absolutely, it could be at any time.
Yeah, yeah. What are some of the ways that, or some of the effects that somebody would have on them from narcissistic abuse? Like, how would somebody that has been abused by a narcissist or is in the middle of being abused by a narcissist present themselves?
Okay, so a lot of victims of abuse I work with will have trauma, and this gets stored in their body. I mean, I know that when I was in a very toxic, abusive relationship, that I had a severe pain in my neck. And it was absolutely awful, that it involved a lot of visits to chiropractors, doctors, but I didn't actually know that what narcissism was at that point, but you know, I think that was kind of stored in my body. But for a lot of victims, they do store trauma in their body. And that can be physical pain. They may develop chronic health problems, such as fibromyalgia. Really awful. Some get cancer, depression, other health problems. But really common things are PTSD or complex PTSD. And this is when you have repetitive flashbacks, nightmares. You may avoid people, difficulty sleeping. Your feelings are much, much more amplified. You know, so let's just say, for example, a door has closed, you know, which has banged shut. It might sound like an explosion to that person. So everything feels worse than it actually is. Really, I think anyone that's gone through narcissistic abuse will have trauma or some kind of PTSD, but I encourage everyone to get into therapy if they can. And it really has to be with a therapist that understands narcissistic abuse. Otherwise, it's not going to be helpful and you'll feel much, much worse. And a good therapist will listen, validate you, and will understand how narcissists operate and how they affect their victims. And I do say posts that you may have seen of mine that can take around 18 to 24 months to recover or to feel any normality. Yes, it does take that long. It sounds like never such a long time, but you've got to be patient with yourself. You know, it's something that I do with my clients, and kind of I say that you need four things for your healing. And that is education on narcissism, understanding how the narcissist brain works, learning boundaries and self-care.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And I know one of the hardest parts of healing is getting to the place from probably education, understanding to boundaries, right? Having the ability to say, no, I'm not doing this anymore. And we flip-flop so much. Absolutely. I did a podcast with Lisa Sunny a while ago, maybe, I don't know, 2 months ago or so. And we talked a lot about cognitive dissonance. And I'm sure that that's what gets in the way of that education and understanding to actually setting boundaries, yes, taking care. What would you say leads to the cognitive dissonance?
Okay. So various factors that lead to a victim feeling trapped with a narcissist. And that is trauma bonding, where you are addicted to the cycle of love and abuse. So the victim develops a sense of loyalty to their abuser with trauma bonding and will do anything for them. Trauma bonds are created when the abuser intermittently love bombs and then abuses you at the same time. They do not abuse all the time, which makes it worse, which is when the love bombing comes in. This then leads the victim to be addicted, and you know, it's to do with your brain chemicals are doing various things to lead to that addiction. So oxytocin is the love hormone, which is triggered by love bombing. Mm-hmm. Dopamine is the addiction hormone, and cortisol is the stress hormone, which gets triggered by the abuse. So together, all of these with the intermittent cycle of love bombing, abuse, love bombing, abuse, and some of them discard as well, just creates that kind of hurricane in the brain. But this leads on to why the victim goes into cognitive dissonance with the trauma bonding, where they actually deny any abuse is taking place. And cognitive dissonance is when you have two conflicting ideas running through your mind simultaneously. On one hand, you know your abuser is bad for you, but in your mind, you downplay that level of abuse. And you make up excuses in your mind that the abuse isn't that bad. It's something that I did, and I kind of ended up lying to myself and probably to others as well and downplaying it. And also you gaslight yourself with that.
Yeah.
Because you tell yourself it's not that bad, stop being so dramatic. And you end up blaming yourself for what is happening in your life. But really, I do say, which leads to the longer you're with an abuser, really the longer it takes to break free, because your brain adjusts to the abuse and your body.
Yeah.
So that's all, they're all kind of tied in together quite well.
If somebody's in that cycle that you named of, you know, abuse, love bombing, what is one thing that someone can do to begin to break free from that cycle within themselves?
Okay. So I'm probably going to maybe share a couple of things that people can do.
Yeah.
That is to actually feel things. Really sit down and feel things and stop gaslighting yourself and tell yourself that your emotions are valid and you have every right to feel them. But a really big thing that people can do, which on the back of that, that really start journaling what has happened and how your abuser has treated you. This will help you to validate your experience and that what you're going through is real. But I always say that only do this if it's safe to do so for safety purposes. If you live with your abuser or abusers, do not keep a paper journal because it could get found by anyone. So your abuser could find it and it puts you at severe risk. So really, you might want to journal on your phone, kind of keep it a passcode. But again, ensure your abuser doesn't know your phone password. But with that, get yourself into therapy. It doesn't matter what stage you're in, whether you're with your abuser or not. It will help you in the process.
Yeah, absolutely. And I thank you so much for sharing those things and touching about why people may not feel comfortable journaling, but giving another idea out there of like, well, you could put a passcode. There's other ways to go about this. I've also heard from some other people to leave the journal at a trusted friend's house or something like that. That so like just to find ways to go about it so that it is secure and that
you're
able to process. I think journaling was one of the things that really helped me, because what I realized was I was being so gaslit all the time that I didn't even know what reality was, because I'd get into these disagreements and I'd be like, that's not at all what happened, or what? Like, you said this. And I just was so like, you have texts and all these things, but I was like, I'm going to go home every day and I'm going to write down what happened today. Like, I'm going to write down, this is the conversation we got into. This was the agreed upon plans. And that actually helped me stop defending myself to them all the time, because I was so clear on where I was.
For sure. another thing, but people, they can, if you go out to work, you could leave your journal in your work office, lock it away in your drawer, but journaling really helps. And I'm so glad that it helped you as well.
Yeah, it was a
wonderful thing. It brings you back to reality, doesn't it?
Totally. Totally.
Absolutely.
This is a question that comes up a lot. It's the last question I have for you before. I would love to hear how we can find you, but I get this question often, and it's, can two narcissists be together in a successful / healthy relationship?
So two narcissists can be together.
Yeah.
But I think it would be rather chaotic. So really, one has to be stronger than the other. For example, a over and the other a covert. They may stay together for years and years. If you get two that are the same, such as the kind of grandiose narcissist, this will be, oh my God, extra chaotic, because they'll both compete against one another and they both have to strive on being and doing better than the other. They cannot love one another, but will be more of a competitive relationship. Really, they both believe they are better than the other, and there will be a lot of arguments and they feel more superior than the other. And I think two the same, they try to change the rules in the house and no one gets it right. I think that it'd be very, very complicated and such a horrible household. But often it's the overt and the covert that get together. The covert narcissist will be quite hard to detect, as the, you know, abuse is quite subtle and they appear to be quite innocent with the shyness, the victimization, and the passive aggressiveness. And then you've got the overt one who will directly abuse, and there's really no hiding the abuse, because it's very, very direct.
Mm-hmm.
Really, and I think in all of this, it's when they have children that it's the children that really suffer the most, because they get caught up in the middle of things and it creates a very, very unsafe environment, with both parents displaying their own instability. So whether it's a covert or an overt narcissist together, they both have something in common.
Mm-hmm.
And that is to gaslight, manipulate, distort your reality, and to brainwash the truth. And this gets projected onto one another as well as the children. It's a very, very chaotic household. So you can get two narcissists together, but I don't think it's a healthy relationship at all.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. It's like, sure, they can be together, you know, and as I was asking you that question, I was just thinking about like the fights between both of them. It must be like the most chaotic two fights of two narcissists like at each other. It would be amazing to watch, honestly.
Absolutely. But it would be a very, very unsafe environment.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. Totally. So I have really enjoyed talking to you. I feel like my brain is like so many little threads that are just going off right now, because this was so informative and so deep, and it touched on so many different things. And I just really appreciate you coming here and giving us your time and educating us on some more of the ins and outs of narcissism.
Oh, thank you so much. I really enjoyed being here and speaking to you today. And I'd love to come back for anything else again.
I
enjoyed that.
I would absolutely love that. And maybe we can do something in the new year.
Absolutely. But
I know people are going to listen to this and wonder how they can find you. And I will put your links below. But I would love if you could tell us where they can find you, what your handle is. And if you could tell us about your book, too, before we end.
Oh, yes. So I wrote a book. It's available on Amazon. And it's called Survival Guide for Toxic Narcissistic Relationships. It's had some wonderful reviews, so I'm so blessed about that. But it's literally just everything that you would want to know about a narcissist. So there's information about trauma bonding, cognitive dissonance, the narcissist brain, divorcing a narcissist. There's a huge chapter in there about parenting with a narcissist, healthy relationships. What else is there? A narcissist red flag. It's a real kind of huge guide for that. It's quite an easy read as well. It's not kind of complicated. And I think the idea for that was that when somebody's going through narcissistic abuse, it can be quite overwhelming. So I think reading kind of very detailed books might seem a bit overwhelming to start with.
Mm-hmm.
So I hope that if anybody buys the book, find it very, very helpful.
Yeah. And you are totally right that sometimes some of the other books and texts can be so overwhelming. So that's awesome.
Exhausting.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So how can we find you?
Oh, yes. So I'm on Instagram, TikTok, YouTube, and goodness, have I missed any more? Pinterest. And if you just put in a Manjit Ruprai, you'll be able to find me on there. But my big following are the kind of TikTok and Instagram and YouTube. But I'm really looking forward to it. I think hopefully in the new year, I will be launching a couple of programs that is to break codependency. And
amazing.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that because I'm a codependent myself. But I've been working quite hard this year whenever I get time in between sessions to put something together. But I will kind of share more information about that. Also looking forward to starting some storytelling as well on narcissistic abuse. So hopefully that will be towards kind of the quarter of the year, I hope, all being well. So yeah, please do follow. We'd love to share with you all.
Awesome. Well, thank you so, so much. And I know that this is going to help so many people.
Oh, thank you so much. I've really looked forward to, really, really enjoyed being here today. Thank you.